Hello, welcome to Kingdom One Online. I'm so glad you're here. At Kingdom One, we exist to build ministries that are courageous, healthy, and effective. And if you're a ministry leader or a pastor or want to see the church become healthy again, you are in the right place. If you're just tuning in, my name is Nick and I am your host today. I have the privilege of working with our marketing and communications department. And if you want to know a secret about Kingdom One, we are constantly praying for you. It's difficult for us as ministry leaders to take time to worship, and this service is tailored for ministry leaders because we can only give something that we practice. The key to developing healthy communities is this principle of practice. Prayer, worship, teaching, these are mainstays because they were in Jesus's life, and so they should be mainstays in our life. We're about to spend 45 minutes together in worship and in teaching, and we hope that you leave this service feeling encouraged, feeling better, even feeling challenged. This is a communion service, so go ahead and grab a cracker and some juice, and we will take communion together after the message. Let's hop into some worship.
Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. perfect love, wrapped within the arms of heaven, in a peace that lasts forever, sinking deep in mercy. See, I'm wide awake, drawing closer by grace, and oh, my heart is yours. All fear removed, I breathe you in, I lean into your love. Oh, 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 your
thank you for worshiping with us. Sinking Deep is a song that rocks me to my core because it constantly highlights the reality that our desires, our identity, and our faith can sometimes, as ministry leaders, be rooted in ourself, in our status, and what other people think about us. Worship is this reminder that Jesus calls us to follow Him and live a life that is worthy of that calling. If we're just meeting for the first time, my name is Nick Ovaya, and at Kingdom One, we realize that a worship opportunity for ministry leaders is difficult. It's few and far in between that you're not working on a service yourself. And so the challenges that we all face and the temptation is the temptation to be modeled after the world. And the Bible says it's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. What it means is our ego mixed with this temptation to follow the world's model of living, it could spell disaster for us as ministry leaders. In today's message, our founder, Stephen Bush, is helping us implement and practice a value of courageous love.
Hi there, my name is Stephen, and I am so excited to get to spend time in God's Word together today. If this is your first time joining us, I'd love to welcome you to our Kingdom One online church service. This time is specifically and intentionally designed for people working in churches, Christian schools, camps, as well as faith-based nonprofits. Our hope is that you can pause and lean into the message that you didn't write and worship along with songs that you didn't have to rehearse. Please, let's make this a space where you can take refuge, you can rest, you can reflect, and be encouraged in your ministry setting. Last time we met, we began a series on being courageous and exploring what biblical courage is and how we can become a courageous church. We read the story of Joshua out of Deuteronomy 31, where God commanded him to be strong and courageous. You remember the passage continues on saying, "The Lord himself, he goes before you, and he will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." We learned about the idea of our identity being like an iceberg on the ocean, with 90% of our identity being beneath the surface. And the deeper our identity is rooted in Jesus, the greater our unseen capacity to be courageous and unswayed by the waves of life. Now, you might wonder why at Kingdom One we talk about courage so much. Well, here are a few stats that came out of surveys of pastors across multiple denominations. 70% of pastors say they have a lower self-esteem now than when they entered ministry. 70% constantly fight depression. 50% of you feel so discouraged that they would leave their ministry if they could, but they can't find another job. 80% of you believe their pastoral ministry has negatively affected your families, and 33% of you said it was an outright hazard. 80% of ministry spouses feel left out and unappreciated in their church. 70% feel they do not have a good marriage. 41% display anger problems in marriage. This has been reported by spouses of pastors. 38% of you are divorced or divorcing. 50% of you admit to using pornography. And 37% report inappropriate sexual behavior with someone in the church. 65% of you feel that your family lives in a glass house. And last but not least, a post-COVID Barna study showed that 46% of pastors under the age of 45 say that they are considering quitting full-time ministry, compared to 34% of pastors 45 and older. Friends, my heart breaks seeing those statistics. Something must be done, and swiftly, to rally around our colleagues in vocational ministry. If you identified with any of those figures and you have nowhere to turn, please connect with us. We want to pray with you and encourage you personally. We are all on an ongoing journey to deepen our icebergs and become more like Jesus. You know, in this season of the history of the church in America, we have such an incredible opportunity to become and remain courageous. If you remember from last time, we distilled courage into three primary ingredients: identity, love, and strength. Our identity, rooted in Jesus, allows us to love as he did and wield our God-given strength to accomplish more than we could ever hope to on our own. Since we know that our identity is found in Jesus, let's turn our attention today to the second ingredient of courage, which is love. And I want to share a few passages of scripture with you about love. This comes from 1 John 4:7 and 8. "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us, that he sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. I also want to read from 1 Corinthians, very famous chapter in the Bible, the love chapter, if you will, and I want to read a few verses here. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Friends, you cannot be courageous without love. Love rooted in Christ is a core ingredient of living a courageous life. Love is our identity being acted out in our lives at our own personal peril. Jesus died for love, and his act on the cross was the most courageous thing that has ever happened on earth. To be courageous like Jesus, we must be ready to follow him in his way of loving others. I'd love to illustrate Christ's love through one of my favorite stories out of the Old Testament, which is the story of Joseph. Warren Wiersbe writes in his commentary, quote, "Joseph is one of the richest illustrations of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. Joseph is like Jesus in that he was beloved by his father and obedient to his will, hated and rejected by his own brethren, and sold as a slave, falsely accused and unjustly punished, and finally elevated from the place of suffering to a powerful throne, thus saving his people from death," end quote. You know, before Joseph's story begins in Genesis 37, we have to take a few minutes to understand the stories leading up to Joseph coming on the scene. You remember Abraham, right? Well, he would be Joseph's great-grandfather. And yep, he and his wife Sarah, well, you remember the story how they doubted the Lord's word and they had a child before Joseph's granddaddy Isaac was born. The division and centuries-long struggle that that decision caused is still felt today as Ishmael was shunned and how we see Israel in the Middle East continuing that family squabble. Well, then his son Isaac, well, he loved his firstborn son Esau, who would be Joseph's uncle. Joseph's grandmother, well, she loved his dad Jacob. Jacob stole his brother Esau's birthright and deceived his grandfather into receiving his blessing. Later on, Joseph's dad would take two wives who would each then sponsor another wife in a really crazy childbirthing competition. Jacob's mom, Leah, was so unloved by his father, she named his half-brothers names like Reuben, which means he has seen my misery, Simeon, which means God hears me, and Levi, which means attached, as she yearned for her husband to finally love her because of the fruit of her womb and the womb of her maidservant. And then Jacob loved Joseph the most out of a dozen sons. Friends, this family was jacked up. What a crazy story of misplaced identity and an ungodly application of love. Pastor, can you imagine having Jacob and his wives in marriage counseling? You might not have enough chairs in your office to talk with all of these folks. Christian school teacher, camp counselor, youth pastor, can you imagine having Jacob's kids in your program? You see, it's so easy sometimes to pass through scripture without thinking about what a train wreck the lives and actions of the folks in these stories truly are. But let's make this more real for us. How many of you today have experienced or in the middle of deep unhealth in your ministry? How many of you have two or more camps vying for your favor? How many of you have experienced relationships shattered by deceit or dishonesty? How many of you have some whom you serve that feel they're owed more by your ministry because they've been there the longest? You see, we're really not so different. The church has its own identity issues. just as some of its greatest biblical heroes, which is why we are tirelessly pursuing the goal of seeing the church become courageous, healthy, and effective. These were real people, and the story reveals to us what an unformed love born out of a lack of depth and identity can do. But as Joseph comes on the scene, it's so important to understand what was going on before he was sold into slavery by his brothers. You see, enmity had been brewing from a lack of courageous, healthy, and effective behavior for generations. It wasn't just a coat in some dreams. It was a deeply distorted identity and a hollow love that sent Joseph into slavery with little guilt or remorse from many of his brothers. But this is not the end of the story, because God was about to do something really powerful through Joseph and ultimately Jesus. And so let's pick up the story in Genesis 39. And if you have your Bibles, you can turn there with me. Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything that he owned. From the time that he put him in charge of his household and of all that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both in the house and in the field. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care with Joseph in charge. He did not concern himself with anything except the food that he ate. The Lord was with Joseph. And obviously, Joseph was also walking with the Lord. His skills and talents were so effective that Potiphar entrusted to his care everything he owned. He essentially became the chief steward of all that Potiphar had. But we know that the story is going to take a turn, and so let's continue reading here in verse 7. Now Joseph was well-built and handsome, and after a while his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, "Come to bed with me." But he refused. "With me in charge," he told her, "my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns, he has entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God?" And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her or even be with her. One day he went into the house and to attend to his duties, and none of the household servants was inside. She caught him by his cloak and said, "Come to bed with me." But he left his cloak in her hand and ran out of the house. When she saw that he had left his cloak in her hand and had run out of the house, she called her household servants. "Look," she said to them, "this Hebrew has been brought to us to make sport of us. He came in here to sleep with me, but I screamed. And when he heard me scream for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house." She kept his cloak beside her until his master came home. Then she took him the story, "That Hebrew slave you bought us came to make sport of me. But as soon as I screamed for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house." When his master heard the story that his wife told him, saying, "This is how your slave treated me," he burned with anger. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those who those held in the prison, and was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. What a crazy story. Joseph ends up in prison for a crime that he didn't commit and for doing the right thing. But what is more amazing about the story is how courageous Joseph was in the narrative. And this is what I mean by that. He continued to demonstrate courage through his identity being anchored in the Father and how he chose to demonstrate godly love in the situation. Here are three practical examples of how Joseph was courageous. Joseph demonstrated courageous love when he resisted the temptation of ego born out of success. We see that despite being a young man and working for one of the most powerful officials in Egypt, he was incredibly successful. His identity could have easily become wrapped up in his success instead of in God. But God was with Joseph. Joseph knew where his success came from and to whom the glory belonged. Success can potentially be a very dangerous experience in ministry. The late Pastor Tim Keller said, quote, "If our identity is in our work rather than Christ, success will go to our heads and failure will go to our hearts," end quote. Friends, if we're not careful, we can come to believe that the success of our ministry is a result of our talents, our skills, our capabilities. The enemy loves nothing more than to invite us to see the fruit of God's work and believe that our hands were more responsible than his. We have to closely guard our hearts and keep our identity rooted in Jesus. Joseph demonstrated courageous love when he resisted the temptation of the flesh. Naturally, as a young man, he could have taken advantage of an opportunity to engage in a physical relationship outside of God's design. Warren Wiersbe quotes an unnamed Puritan preacher who said, quote, "Joseph lost his coat, but he kept his character," end quote. Joseph did something really incredible in honoring God by demonstrating true Christ-like love to Potiphar's wife. You see, this love recognized that what she truly needed was to find her fulfillment in her relationship with her husband, whom he served. And he did it at his own peril, as we see played out in the story, where his actions led him into an unjustified punishment. Now, you might wonder, why am I drawing a connection between resisting temptation of the flesh with love? And it's because this brief chapter contains a really powerful lesson for us, particularly for us working in vocational ministry. Just as Jesus came to earth to point us to the Father, and not even truly to serve us, but first and foremost to do his Father's will, he too resisted temptation because of his love for the Father. Friends, I want to invite you to recognize how we maybe can insert ourselves as ministry leaders and staff into the role of Joseph, and the ministries where we lead and serve into the role of Potiphar's wife. You see, we work in the house of our master. We too have been entrusted with much and given spiritual authority to steward a great deal of resources for the purpose of reaching the lost and making disciples for Jesus. We own nothing in our master's house, and as we see in the parable of the talents, Matthew 25, any increase wrought by our actions is entirely for his glory, so we can share in our master's happiness. Can I just share gently that we too can sometimes see the affections of the bride of Christ, the church, turn from the groom to the steward. We ourselves can become the focus of affection. Friends, let's examine our hearts for a brief minute. How have we invited or allowed or perpetuated an affair with the bride of Christ? Have we at times or even gradually over time shifted our identity to become more anchored in our pastoral office, our theological positions, our politics, our plans, our strategies, our influence, our brand name recognition, our social media engagement, ultimately shifted towards ourselves? Now, I share this not to accuse you. These questions are aimed right back at me as well. I share this to call us to action, as Joseph did, to point the bride back to the groom. Friends, we must flee temptation, even if it means leaving your cloak behind. The Apostle Peter exhorts us in 1 Peter 5 to be a shepherd of God's flock that is under your care, and to watch over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you'll receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Warren Wiersbe shares these thoughts in his commentary on this passage, and I quote, "Today, a Christian worker may labor for different kinds of rewards. Some work hard to build personal empires. Others strive for the applause of men. Still others seek promotion within their denomination. All of these things will fade one day. The only reward we should strive for is the well done of the Savior. We will have no desire for personal glory when we see Jesus Christ face to face," end quote. When we see Jesus at the Bema Seat in heaven, may we be able to share with confidence that we earnestly, constantly, incessantly, vigorously stewarded all that he entrusted to us, especially the affections of his bride. Our integrity in that moment will be worth so much more than the cloak of earthly glory that the enemy offers us. Lastly, Joseph demonstrated courageous love when he resisted surrendering his identity. By remaining true to God's calling on his life and therefore demonstrating God's love, Joseph's identity remained firmly rooted in the Father. His iceberg deepened. The generational identity crisis was not perpetuated. And even as Joseph headed into prison and perhaps the lowest point in his life, let's read this verse again. And it's Genesis 39:20. "But while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness, and he granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden." The Lord was with him, just as the Lord was with Joshua and went before him and the people of Israel. How many of us would love to have this chapter to be one that could be written about our lives and our ministry? Friends, this can be our story, as it is in so many ministries throughout our country. I know many of you are humbly and courageously serving the Lord, and I would encourage all of us to continue pressing into living a courageous life. In closing, we have seen how to be courageous is to have our identity rooted in Jesus. And when Jesus is our identity, we love as he loves. We have hope because of the work Jesus did on the cross, but also the work he's doing in our hearts, shaping us to become more like him. I want to invite you to take this week to answer these questions, and through reflection, I pray that you will find a new sense of courageous love. The first question is, as I consider my identity in Christ, are there ways that he loves me that I need to now demonstrate to those in my life? The second is, as a ministry leader or staff member, how am I examining my heart to ensure I always point those whom I serve back to Jesus and never towards myself? And third, have I grown discouraged or felt abused, even after doing the right thing? How can I sit in the reality that the Lord is with me? He will never leave me nor forsake me. I'd like to invite you to join us next time as we complete our study of courageous and learning about the final dimension to courageous living, which is strength. Let me close in prayer. Father, thank you so much for these incredible pastors, ministry leaders, ministry staff, Father, who every day are showing up and they're on mission, and they are all about serving your kingdom, God, and reaching the people that you have placed within their sphere of influence. Lord, I do pray that you would continue to mold and shape us, God. Would you chip away the things that don't reflect Christ in our lives and in our ministries, Lord? Help us to become more courageous. Help us to demonstrate the love that Jesus demonstrates to us. And would you grow and mold each of us as we all embark upon this work, Lord, to see your church be courageous, healthy, and effective. We love you, God. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
So great to hear from Stephen and his perspective on courageous love. We're about to take communion, and as the practice of taking communion is examining and taking stock of our life, and I would ask the question, where's your identity? If I'm being honest with you, my identity can drift to my self-worth, to what other people think of me, to my accomplishments and the accolades that I could point back to. And the stats that Stephen shared are hard to swallow. It's really true that the church isn't healthy because some of us aren't healthy. And I want to let you know it's okay to not be okay, even in ministry, but it's not okay to stay that way. The first step is surrounding yourself with people who will hold you accountable. Leadership at its core is accountability. And as we move into communion, will you start to make the confession of where your identity is currently as we start to move our identity into Jesus? And so I love what Paul says in this scripture from 1 Corinthians has a lot of truth to it. And it should remind us as ministry leaders what communion means. He says, let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why so many of you are weak, ill, and have died. The Greek word for that is also falling asleep. So what Paul is warning us here is not to be numb, not to be asleep, not to be dead in our relationship with communion and in turn the communities that we lead. So as I pray for us, would you bow your head and close your eyes as we pray for this communion? Dear God, as ministry leaders, let us not fall victim to what this world is offering, to its divisiveness, to its identity politics, to its condemnation of others to feed the ego. I pray for us that we would have a deep conviction as ministry leaders to point people back to your word, to your works, and to your son, Jesus, the Messiah. Not to ourselves, not to our cultural ways, not to our affiliations. Let us not be asleep to the sacrifice that you made for your people. And let us not become weak in our relationships with other Christians. Help us to commune with your presence, with our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And let us not forget that our identity is rooted in you in this courageous love. I pray that we would continue to change the world as ministry leaders as we point back to you, Jesus. Let us remember your body and your blood poured out for sins. And allow us to uphold the integrity of what this meal means that symbolizes your triumphant return. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. You may take the bread and the cup. If you ever need to talk to somebody about what's happening in your ministry, what's keeping you up at night, or any tough projects that come across your desk, we're here to help. You can email us at hello@kingdomone.co. And I want to say thank you for joining us today in worship. Kingdom One is supported in part by donations from people like you. If you want to support the mission of courageous, healthy, and effective ministry, you can visit kingdomone.co/give. Thank you for your giving, and until we chat again, let's grow the church together.